Hi, I'm Martin Cole, and I'm the Science Director for Agriculture and Food at Australia's National Science Agency, the CSIRO, and I'm the current chair of the International Commission on the Microbiological Specifications for Food, or ICMSF. And it's a pleasure to spend a few minutes with you today to tell you a little bit of background and history of the Commission. And I'll try and do this in a way that will hopefully also give you a good overview of the development of food safety management over the years. The ICMSF is a non-government organisation, or NGO, under the International Union of Microbiological Societies within the International Council of Science. And the Commission has a very long history. It was formed in 1962, and over the years it's held 50 annual meetings in 28 different countries. It was established to provide independent and impartial advice to government agencies to help reduce the incidence of microbiological foodborne illness and spoilage, and also to help facilitate trade. Current membership consists of 19 members from 17 different countries. Members are from government, academia, and industry, and have a broad experience in food safety and spoilage. Members are selected on technical expertise, not as national delegates. And we also have an extensive network of consultants to help us in our work. All work is voluntary and without honorarium. One key point is that our recommendations have no official status. While our recommendations and advice may be considered by national governments, it is their role to develop food standards and regulations. One of our key outputs are position papers and publications on a wide range of topics, including HACCP, sampling plans, and other risk management concepts. By far the main product, though, of the Commission has been the series of books, Microorganisms in Food. Over the years, the Commission has often led the development of new concepts in food microbiology, and I'd like to spend a few minutes taking you through the books and how they have influenced our thinking on microbial risk management of foods. When the Commission started, in the 1960s, there was a lot of confusion on microbial standards, mainly due to the fact that around the world, people were using different microbial methods and analyses that gave different results. So much of the early work of the Commission was to do with trying to establish testing methods that could be agreed upon and standardized internationally. Another key focus of the early work of the Commission was the aspect of sampling statistics and testing. It might be tempting to try to test all food before it's consumed to make sure it's safe. But, to be honest, if we did that, we'd have no food left to eat, would we? In practice, we can only really sample a small proportion of the food that we eat. But even if we take a large number of samples, there's still a probability that we will miss contaminated lots. In the end, it's usually a trade-off between how many samples we can practically test against how sure we want to be of finding contamination, should it be there. And book two established a number of cases that relate the stringency of sampling to the severity of the hazard that we're trying to control. And the book formed the basis of many national and internationally agreed microbiological criteria, and was even gazetted into food law in a number of countries. Now, recognizing the limitations, though, of microbial sampling and end product testing, the global food community started to look at hazard analysis and critical control point, or HACCP, as a systematic way of controlling hazards through the use of critical control points in the production of food that could deliver a validated control measure such as a heating step. And the Commission did a lot of the early thinking around HACCP and how it can be applied to food. Now, it was around this time that the ICMSF also started some work on the microbial ecology of food. Just think of the vast array of foods involved in international trade, each with their own characteristics and unique microflora. In book five in the series provided a summary of the conditions of food that would influence whether key microorganisms would be inactivated, would survive or grow. And this was important for establishing and validating critical control points in HACCP. These days we have predictive microbial models that allow us to predict the way microorganisms behave in food. In book six, the group updated the information on the microbial ecology of food to help understand which microorganisms are of concern in different foods and how the formulation and processing will affect the safety and spoilage of food. Now, by the 1990s, the volume of food traded internationally had more than tripled since 1960. and was now at $300 to $400 billion. And there was a lot of trade disputes related to the safety of exports. In response, the World Trade Organization, or WTO, was formed in 1994 to help regulate and facilitate international trade. And in 1996, the WTO member states signed the Sanitary and Phytosanitary, or SPS, agreement that essentially said that when countries develop sanitary or phytosanitary measures, they should be based on risk and based on scientific principles. Now, this had a major impact in the way that food safety standards were developed. It meant that we had to move from a hazard-based approach to one based on risk. Now, this is great in principle, but the key issue was, how could we relate a risk-based or public health goal into something that can be translated to HACCP or standards that could be practically used by industry? So this issue led to the next work of the ICMSF in Book 7, where the Commission developed a risk management framework that made the link between public health goals and control measures. This work introduced new concepts, such as the food safety objective, that defined the level or concentration of a hazard at the point of consumption that would provide an acceptable level of protection. The book introduced the framework and discussed approaches to validate control measures, and also included some worked examples for different foods. So this brings me to the latest publication of the Commission, Book 8, which actually comes full circle and links the performance now of sampling plans and testing in the context of risk management. So that's the series of books in English, but what has been really important for our impact worldwide has been the work of many sub-commissions and working groups who have helped translate the books into Spanish, Portuguese, Japanese, and Mandarin, and even cartoons. Another success factor has been the fact that we've held many workshops and training events around the world, and we always try to include local experts to ensure that we are relevant to that region. So look, after 50 years, although the Commission may look a little different, its work is just as relevant today as it was then, and perhaps even more relevant. In the next 40 years, we will consume as much food as we have consumed in the previous 500. During the time of the Commission, we've doubled the amount of available food, but this has come at quite a cost to the planet. In the next 40 years, it's estimated we'll need to increase the amount of food by 70%, but this time we'll have to halve the environmental footprint, which is a huge challenge. So the current work of the Commission is focused on what new approaches that we will need to control the safety and stability of food in order to meet the challenges of global food security. So to conclude, the ICMSF has a long history of contributions to the microbial safety and spoilage of food. Advances in risk management have come full circle and now allow sampling and testing to be more risk-based. Looking ahead at the future challenges we face, it's crucial that we continue to develop new approaches to ensure that food safety and stability is an enabler, not a barrier to global food security. Thank you.